There once were a couple of pirates, adrift on the ocean, and in danger of dying from thirst. Fortunately, it started raining into their bucket. The pirates are saved. But hold on, the rain is caused by steam from a tea kettle hitting foil-wrapped ice held by a giant hand. And if all that isn't disconcerting enough, the raft can't support the weight of both the rainwater and the pirates. It would have been a disaster, except for the fact that the whole exercise was meant to illustrate the water cycle. A cause for which the pirates are happy to go swimming. Welcome to Science Mom's Guide to Water Part 7. In our previous 6 videos, we covered water's properties of cohesion, adhesion, capillary action, surface tension, and being a universal solvent. And in this video, we're going to explore how water changes state with 5 hands-on activities. Evaporation sensation, water cycle in a jar, rain in a jar, pulling water from dirt, and balloons that don't pop. I'm wrapping 4 thermometers in napkins. You can see that the current temperature is about 80 degrees Fahrenheit, which is quite warm. We'll leave one of the napkins dry, this is our control, and we'll place oil, water, and rubbing alcohol on the other napkins. Before we turn on the fan, I want you to make a prediction. Which thermometer do you think will have the largest drop in temperature, and why? Pause the video and make your prediction. Now let's turn on the fan and find out. 10 minutes later, our control and the thermometer wet with oil have not changed, but the thermometer wet with water has dropped over 10 degrees Fahrenheit, and the thermometer wet with rubbing alcohol has dropped even further. If you'd like to test this out on your skin, just wet the back of your hand with different liquids, and then place your hand in front of a fan or blow on it. You can feel how your skin instantly becomes cooler when it's wet with water or rubbing alcohol, but not with oil. This happens for a few reasons. First, oil does not evaporate as readily as water or rubbing alcohol, and second, oil does not have bonds that it shares with its neighbors. Water and rubbing alcohol do. And any time that you are breaking bonds, you are going to be using energy. When the water molecule evaporates and rises up into the atmosphere, those hydrogen bonds are broken, and that requires energy. And so the water and the rubbing alcohol, they pull energy from the surroundings in the form of heat. And that's why you have that evaporative cooling with those liquids. And the reason why rubbing alcohol drops even more and cools even more than water is because you have a lot quicker rate of evaporation with rubbing alcohol. If you pour hot water into a glass and then put a plate on top with ice on it, water vapor condenses on the sides of the glass. We've got all 3 states of matter here together, gas, liquid, solid, and if you watch carefully for several minutes, you can see water collect on the bottom of the plate and then fall back into the liquid water below. And you'll see water condensing on the side of the glass and droplets running together and getting larger and going back down into the liquid water at the bottom of the jar. Cooling water vapor down with ice to make a cloud takes quite a while. There's a way we can do it faster with a bike pump, a cork, and a 2-liter bottle. I have a little bit of rubbing alcohol in this bottle. The rubbing alcohol in here has quite a bit of water in it, and as we learned before, it evaporates much quicker than water, so we get more vapor from the rubbing alcohol itself in here as well. And if I begin to pump this bike pump, putting pressure into our 2-liter container, I'm also increasing the temperature slightly because temperature and pressure are correlated. And as soon as I release the pressure by nudging off this cap, we get a cloud. Now this is pretty neat to see because it's so dramatic. That sudden drop in temperature instantly causes all of the rubbing alcohol and the water vapor to condense. And if I increase the temperature a little bit by repressurizing the bottle, I can make this cloud disappear. Ooh. Clouds that you see in the atmosphere are most often made up of very small water droplets, or ice particles, depending on the elevation. When those water droplets are very, very small, they remain airborne. But as the clouds build and become larger, more and more of the droplets collide and come together and they get bigger. And if the raindrops reach a certain size, then they're too heavy to remain aloft and they descend to the ground. And we have precipitation, or rain. There's a fun way to model this using shaving cream and water in a jar. This isn't an exact model of a cloud by any means, but it's a fun illustration of how density can drive movement. First, spread shaving cream on top of warm water. Smooth it off with a knife or your finger so the top is completely covered and even. Then drop about 5 drops of food coloring into 1 spot on the shaving cream. It helps to wait a few seconds in between each drop so they don't get too large. Observe from the side. If you want, you can use a water dropper to help add a little additional weight and chase the food coloring liquid down and through the shaving cream. Be patient, it often takes a minute or two, but soon the color will emerge into the water and beautifully rain down to the bottom of the jar. I'm in the middle of the desert. It hasn't rained in weeks, and the nearest water is in the Colorado River, miles and miles away. But I can fill up a glass of water right here using just a shovel and a sheet of plastic. The first step is to dig a large hole. Then place a bowl in the center, cover the hole with a tarp or a plastic drop cloth, and place small rocks or other weights in the center of the tarp so that the low point is directly over the bowl. Then wait overnight, and the next morning come back to check on your water collecting contraption. With luck, the change in temperature that your hole experienced as it went from day to night and back to day will have caused water to evaporate from the soil, condense on the plastic, and then run down the slope and drip into the bowl. You can do this on a smaller scale by placing dirt into a container and covering it.
Pretty cool. I don't know that I want to drink it. Should I taste it?
No.
Yep. We pulled this water from the soil here just using plastic and a shovel. Pretty cool. Totally desperate and starving in the desert. That might buy you another half a day of life, maybe.
Yep.
Depending on how hot it was. So, yeah. Pretty cool.
If you bring a balloon close to something hot, like a candle flame, it'll pop almost instantly. But if there's water in the balloon to absorb that heat, then it's different. I'm gonna have Math Dad test out some balloons to see what happens when we have different amounts of water in the balloon. He'll do an empty one with 1 teaspoon of water, a couple tablespoons of water, and a balloon that has about a half cup of water. Go ahead and try it. Now get your next balloon, which has a little bit of water in it. Like a teaspoon of water in there, maybe?
Yeah.
Not very much. All right, go ahead and touch that to the balloon.
Yep.
How long do you think you can hold it there?
My arm will get tired in a few minutes.
All right, go ahead and pick up the next one. And this one has a lot of water.
This has got at least a half a cup.
So we've held the balloon on that long enough, it's made a burnt spot on the bottom, but it hasn't popped yet. The more water, the longer the balloon takes to pop because water has a high specific heat. Specific heat refers to water's heat capacity, the amount of heat that 1 gram of something loses or gains to change temperature 1 degree is called its heat capacity, and water has a much higher heat capacity than so many other things. Take, for example, sand. If you had the same amount of sand and water and you wanted to raise the temperature of both of them by 1 degree, you would need to apply 5 times more heat to the water to get that same temperature raise. It's really quite impressive. I hope you enjoyed the water series. Our book recommendation for this last video is Science Mom's Guide to Water Part 1. You can, of course, check down in the description to print out your free foldable book that can fold down into a miniature pocket-sized book. But if you would like to see more comics, explanations, mazes, puzzles, then check out the Science Mom's Guide to Water series. That's it. Work hard, grow smart, and I'll see you next time.
This was a fail. I thought I had the camera recording and I didn't, and we didn't get any water in the cups. We definitely collected some water, but the problem is we collected a lot of dirt too. So, yeah. I mean, technically, you'd get maybe a teaspoon of water you could drink from that.
It's getting high enough that when the pressure releases, thank you.